With your permission, Lord Jesus, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The patron saint of parish priests said, "A priest is a man who would die to be one." That was his definition, and he defined it by his whole life. So you really don't have to pay any attention to anything else I have to say today, because then I'll end up saying the same thing again. A priest is a man who would die to be one. And Vianney knew, literally, the cost of the priesthood. He lived in a very difficult time. Now, when people say that, though, we have to remember that every time is difficult. Every age has its severe problems. But the age in which he lived has some uncanny parallels with ours as well. It was a time of terrible skepticism, aridity of spirit. He was born in 1786, just 3 years before the cataclysmic French Revolution. And that included what is called the Reign of Terror, during the space of a little more than a year, from 1791 to 1792, thousands of people were slaughtered. The irony, of course, is that this was supposed to be the age of reason. Well, it's very hard to reason when you've had your head cut off. And that happened to thousands of people. Some 30,000 priests and religious were exiled or imprisoned. Hundreds upon hundreds were killed. A chief supervisor of the slaughtering of priests was Joseph Fouché, who himself had been a Sulpician lay brother. He rebelled against the very faith that he had wanted to consecrate himself to. And so in this macabre period, we see something more than a philosophical or a political disagreement. We see the devil at work. And all through his life, Vianney took the devil seriously. And the devil returned the compliment. The devil famously said to Vianney once, "If there were two more priests like you in France, my days would be over." But this hostility to the faith did not originate in the revolution. It was actually an infection of Holy Church herself. There were many skeptics who professed to be bishops and priests and religious. They had fallen for the new idea. They thought that they could be as gods themselves. But we know that's not a very new idea. It goes back to the beginning of the human race. There's a famous quotation. Some statesmen have used it from time to time. "I see things, some see things that are and ask why. I dream of things that are not and ask why not." Those sound delicious words, inspiring words. But actually, George Bernard Shaw, in his play Back to Methuselah, put those words on the lips of Satan. The denial of reality, and also a dream of a fantasy that one wants things to be. Saint Jean Vianney did not dream vain dreams. He lived in a real world, and he knew the consequences of the denial of God. As a boy, he had to be confirmed in secret because of the persecution of the church. He had a very hard time learning his catechism. He just didn't have that kind of brain. But we have to remember as well that his intelligence was of a gifted kind. He was very bright. And the one treasure he kept from the pastor who finally saw him through to ordination was the library of that pastor. Many times in his life, he would be found by the sexton early in the morning, asleep on the vestment press in the sacristy. He had been spending all night copying outlines from the fathers. He himself said he was not a very smart man, but the saints, as he put it, were. And the treasury of the saints, he said, is meant to be plundered. That's no license for plagiarism, but what he is saying is that the truth of God is spoken through the saints and they pass it on to us. And so with that gift of faith, he was able to confound the curse of cynicism. For cynicism was the real problem, not what we call rationalism. Rationalism is a misuse of reason, avoiding the truth, using by a misuse of the mind. But cynicism is the inspiration for that kind of misuse of the mind. There was a famous wit in the 18th century, the Marquise de Dufond. She had a salon when she had witty repertoires with people in Parisian society, and one of was D'Alembert, a famous rationalist, one of the writers of the rationalist encyclopedia. He challenged her once, mocking the story of St. Denis when he was martyred, refusing to be buried in pagan soil. And so according to the legend, St. Denis picked up his head and carried it to the Ile Saint-Louis so he could be buried in a churchyard. The response of the Marquise was very simple. She says the real problem with the story is not the distance that he walked, but the first step. La distance n'y fait rien, il y a que le premier pas qui coûte. And so she used her sophistication in the best kind of witty way to remind D'Alembert that there are legends, but there are also facts. Consider Joan of Arc. If Joan of Arc had not been so carefully witnessed and her words so carefully transcribed, she would be passed off today as a legend. A teenage girl leading an army, saving her country, getting a king crowned. And yet that was a fact. The same thing can be said of Vianney. The accomplishments of his life were so beyond our imagination that it would be very easy to say that these stories were made up. But he was witnessed by thousands and thousands of people. He knew that at the essence of the priestly life is humility. And that humility is the key to greatness. It enables us to undertake great works without fear of human respect. We know famously once in the priests of his, what we call a deanery, sent around a petition to the bishop asking the bishop to remove Vianney because he was a simpleton. Well, this was a general mailing, and Vianney was on the mailing list. When he got the petition and read it, he signed it. And that helped convert the other priests. John Henry Newman, whose prayer we just heard, was one of the great intellects of all time. Happily now, although we can assume he already is enjoying the company of the curé d'Ars, yeah, he probably will be, I hope, declared a doctor of the church as well as canonized a saint later this year. He was a contemporary of Vianney, never met him, but had heard much about him. He died about 30 years after Vianney. The very last thing he asked to be read to him by Father Neville, and I have a book that Newman had given to Neville and inscribed, the very last reading he wanted was a life of John Vianney. This would, of course, amaze Vianney. Once, the great Dominican preacher in France, Lacordaire, went to see Vianney and preached from the little pulpit, rickety pulpit, in that tiny church. Vianney could not understand why Lacordaire had made the trip down there, that the greatest of intellects should have come to the least of the intellects in France. That's how he put it, but it's not how Lacordaire put it. Lacordaire, when he came down from the pulpit, was weeping. As Father Neville was reading this pious life of Vianney, typical kind of syrupy life, like some of those prayer cards that tried to beautify the saints, Newman, even though he was in his death throes, said, "No, read no more. That does not show us the man." Newman wanted the truth of the man. What was the bond in the life of Newman and the life of Vianney? They both were men who would die in order to be a priest. In his lectures on the idea of a university, Newman writes, in one of the most beautiful passages, "Quarry the granite rock with razors, or moor the vessel with a thread of silk, and then you may hope, with such keen and delicate instruments as human knowledge and human reason, to contend against those giants, the passion and the pride of man." The passion and the pride of man. Newman knew those dangers, and so did Vianney. That was their bond, a common bond in the priesthood. Vianney said, a priest is a man who brings Jesus to the people. For some years, off and on, I worked with Mother Teresa of Calcutta, Saint Teresa, but we instinctively call her Mother. For what greater title is there than that? Mother Cabrini, Mother Seton, so on. And after Mass, Mother would kiss the hand of the priest. "Thank you for bringing Jesus to me." She knew very well the flaws of priests, and she was not beneath correcting priests sometimes. Once she said to a priest after a Mass, "Thank you for the Mass." She didn't like what he had preached, and she said, "But do not come back again." A characteristic of the revolution was the hatred of priests. I think it was Paul Caudel who said, "Every tyranny is marked by a hatred of priests." There are many bad things through history done, but through the misuse of the priesthood. But the hatred of priests is diabolic. For the priest is the altar Christus. The Antichrist cannot stand the presence of Christ. A friend of mine just the other day was talking to a government official who was also a psychiatrist. And I'm not sure what the subject was, but in the course of it, he mentioned that he was a Catholic. And the psychiatrist said that he had been a Catholic, but was now an atheist. And then he said very chillingly, "We can't meet anymore, because we are out to destroy you." He said, "What do you mean?" "My profession, my psychiatric profession. We are out to destroy the Catholic Church, for you are the enemy." Now, not all psychiatrists say that. I have some friends, very good friends, who use the science world. But that was revealing. When we hear bad things about the priesthood, we have to remember much of it is warranted, because the most sacred of all states of life, the priesthood, is easily warped by the Antichrist. But it is also the Antichrist who will use every tool at his disposal to destroy the church, and he has to do that by destroying the priesthood. If you go to ours, you can see on the wall where, on one occasion, by the testimony of the cure himself, Satan had flung fire at him. On another occasion, when he was giving retreat in a nearby village, the other priests heard shouting and they ran upstairs, and there was Vianney being spun around in his bed. Satan hates priests because the priests bring Jesus to the people and the priest absolves sin. Vianney once heard the confession of a young university student who made his confession kneeling on a prie-dieu, during the course of which the floor began to tremble and the young man was knocked to the ground. Vianney picked the fellow up, dusted him off, and said, "Do not be afraid, young man. It is only the devil." And the young man said, "I was so moved by the holiness of the cure, but I must confess I never went back to him for conversion again." We know how the actor Alec Guinness was converted to Christianity, to Catholicism, when he was making a film based on one of the detective stories of G.K. Chesterton. At the end of the day, going back to the hotel where the rest of the cast were staying in France, a young boy just came out of the bushes, took his hand, and began talking to him as though he was his father. Guinness was very moved by this, that this boy trusted this man whom he had never met simply because he could see the way he was dressed that he was a priest. And we know in our own day the terrible efforts Satan has made to destroy that bond. How did Vianney handle the devil? Well, the devil is the prince of pride. And so he mocked the devil. He called him Garapin, which really means like a pruning fork. He mocked the devil because mockery destroys pride. And yet, people know that without the priest, there is no understanding of Christ. That's why our Lord gave us the priesthood. Even in a cynical world, there is a certain trust between souls and the priest who represents the church that's unlike anything else. I was on a train once, Metro North, seated next to a young woman who saw my collar and asked, "Are you a Catholic priest?" I said, "Yes." And she said, "Well, good. Would you wake me up when we get to White Plains?" My intuition was she would not have trusted me to do that if I had been a Methodist. And yet there are people who have to be told about that trust. Shortly after, or just a couple of days after September 11, 2001, I was on a train going to Philadelphia. And a young fellow sat next to me with some tattoos and it rings in his ears, a cool dude. And we were talking about the World Trade Center and what had happened there. I told him the priest next to me had been killed. I had his body. And we placed the body in St. Peter's Barclay Street in front of the altar. Over the altar is a painting of the crucifixion that Mother Seton used to pray before. And that priest's body was dripping blood down the altar steps. And in that church as well were some of the firemen weeping in shock. And I told this young fellow that these firemen were asking me as a priest, to give them absolution before they went into the burning towers. I shall always remember that scene. It was like a battle scene. I couldn't hear every confession. Gave general absolution. And the young fellow said, well, why did they go into the building if it was on fire? And I said, well, they went in to rescue people. And the young fellow said, if they did that, they must be sick. Well, that is the voice of a cynical generation, no different from some of those cynics in the 18th century. But that culture also gave birth to Vianney and to a renewal of the church. For we have to remember, within some 30 to 40 years after those terrible terrors, the church bloomed and became the very epicenter of a new worldwide missionary movement. Vianney said, when you confess your sins, you take the nails out of Jesus. Déclouer de la croix. You take the wounds. They take the nails out of Jesus. But it takes humility to confess one's sins. And it was the humility of Vianney that brought others to him. We have to remember. Toward the end of his life, some 80,000 people a year made the long journey from all over Europe and even from the United States to go to confession to him, and they had to wait sometimes a week. Pope Benedict XVI, in one of his books, before he was Pope, quoted the abbot Apollo, an Egyptian monk, I think, who had an apparition of Satan. And the one curiosity was that Satan had no knees. Satan cannot kneel. And he doesn't want us to kneel. He doesn't want us to kneel before Christ because Christ is the truth. He wants us to worship death itself. Some years ago, the Euthanasia Society, the Hemlock Society, published a book on recipes for poisoning yourself. I was crossing Park Avenue with the late lamented Justice Scalia. And I told him as we crossed the street that the Dalton book chain had put that book on the shelf in the section self-improvement. The justice stopped right in the middle of the traffic. That's not true, I said. Yet, yes, it is true. Well, that's the language of the devil. The devil is always wanting us to dream things that are not, because he doesn't want us to believe things that are. He wants us to live in illusion. He wants us to define our own reality. I had a very curious letter from a woman once who said she had taped one of my television shows and played it over again. And she said that I seemed more relaxed the second time. Well, this is what I think Cardinal Ratzinger meant by the dictatorship of relativism. Our Lord is the way, the truth, and the life. He doesn't simply say, I will show you the way. Philosophers do that. He doesn't say, I will tell you the truth. Teachers do that. He doesn't say, I will give you life. Our parents do that. But he says, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. Vianney prayed constantly. His whole life was a prayer. His day began about 1 o'clock in the morning. He would go to the church. He would make his meditation. He would hear for several hours the confessions of women. And then he offered mass, made his thanksgiving, had a very simple breakfast, usually just of a half a cup of milk. We know he lived on just a few potatoes a week. He would speak to people in the village square. Then he would hear the men's confessions. Then he'd go off for what he called lunch, but it really wasn't lunch at all. Then he would give catechism instruction to the children. Then he would hear more confessions. And he would usually go to bed no earlier than 10, very often at 11. But at 1 o'clock, he was back in the church. Almost his whole life, his whole 41 years in that one parish, he kept trying to leave it to pray for his poor soul. The bishop wouldn't let him go. The parishioners would drag him back 3 times. But all those times, all those years, on an average, 2 hours of sleep a day. But it was a prayer. Everything he did was a prayer. He said, prayer is very simple. It's just two friends talking together. Is the devil that makes it difficult. When the cure arrived at ours, because it was such a remote place, he had a little boy show him the way. It was so remote that they spoke their own dialect, their patois. The boy wasn't anxious to show him the village because the previous priest had died of tuberculosis. It was a very swampy place. A priest before him had abandoned the priesthood. The whole place had a very bad reputation. But when they got to the border of the village, Vianney said to the boy, you have shown me the road to Ars, and now I will show you the road to heaven. Tu m'as montré le chemin d'Ars, je te montrerai le chemin du ciel. That little boy, André Gives, never forgot that. 41 years passed. When Vianney died, his body was taken out of the presbytery into the garden to be photographed for the first time. He would never allow himself to be photographed, the old daguerreotype system. Once he saw a well-known sculptor in the back of the church with a bowl of wax trying to sculpt him, and he ordered him out of the church. He said, they are making me into a clown, and this is a carnival. But when he realized the people were calling him a saint, he became so upset. On one occasion, he went into the village square and began to dance around as though he were a fool. But that only impressed the people much the more. Some 8,000 people came to his funeral. And at the head of the funeral cortege, in front of the clergy, was Antoine Gives, who had been that boy so many years before. And it was to that man that Vianney said, what every priest is obliged by his ordination to tell his people, I will show you the road to heaven. I thank you, my Lord, for the good resolutions, affections which you have communicated to me in this meditation. I ask your pardon for my sins and the grace to put them to effect. Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my Immaculate Mother, Saint John Vianney, pray for us.